بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. As we continue with the explanation of Surah Sad, we will go on to the ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions some more prophets. So far in this surah, we have been going over partial stories of some of the prophets. First, we went over the story of Dawood alayhi salam, part of the story of Dawood alayhi salam that is mentioned in this surah. And then we went on to the son of Dawood alayhi salam, Sulaiman alayhi salam, and we mentioned the part of his story that is also mentioned in this surah. And then last week, we went over the story of the great prophet, the prophet of patience, Ayyub alayhi salam. Now the next few ayat mention a number of prophets as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرْ عِبَادَنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ أُولِي الْأَيْدِي وَالْأَبْصَارِ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands to remember his servants, Ibrahim and Ishaq and Ya'qub. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions these prophets of his in this ayah, but he doesn't go into the details of their stories in this surah. Rather, the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the story of Ya'qub alayhi salam, these stories are mentioned elsewhere in the Quran. The story of Ya'qub alayhi salam is mentioned in Surah Yusuf, and the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned in many surahs throughout the Quran. But in this surah, they are just mentioned by name without mentioning their stories. And we have mentioned in our series on the stories of the prophets, we have already went over the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam and his sons Ismail and Ishaq alayhi salam. And when we mentioned the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, we also went over the story of his father Yaqub alayhi salam. So there's no need to go into details about the stories of these prophets because we have already spoken about this before. But here in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, he reminds us of these prophets and to remember their stories. وَذْكُرْ عِبَادَنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ أُولِي الْأَيْدِي وَالْأَبْصَارِ. And remember our servants Ibrahim and Ishaq and Ya'qub, أُولِي الْأَيْدِي وَالْأَبْصَارِ. They were people who had strength and they were people who had vision. They had strength in terms of their commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in terms of their resistance to the shaitan. And they had vision in terms of their obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They always had their eyes on the hereafter. Rather than thinking about this dunya, their main focus and their main goal was the hereafter. And this is what we call vision, to have vision. And even in a worldly sense, when you hear the word vision, oh, this man has a vision, it means he's not just looking at what's happening right now in front of him. Rather, he's looking at a long-term goal. This is a person who had vision. Usually when you hear about some of the famous entrepreneurs, like when you talk about Steve Jobs, for example, you say, oh, Steve Jobs is a person who had vision, because he wasn't just looking at what was in front of him, rather he had a long-term planning and a long-term goal that he worked to get to. So whenever you talk about the word vision, this is what you're talking about. Someone who looks at the future and is looking at the long-term. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that these prophets were people of vision, it means that they always had their sights on the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they were patient for what was to come for them in the hereafter. So they were ulil aidi wal absar. They were people of strength and they were people of vision. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to describe these prophets, inna akhlasnahum bi khalisatin dhikra ad-dar. Surely we gave these people a special quality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave these people, Ibrahim and Ishaq and Ya'qub, a special quality. And that special quality was dhikra ad-dar, remembrance of the hereafter. They would think about the hereafter and they would plan for the hereafter, and they would act in this world with the intention of getting reward in the hereafter. And this is a special quality that only those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed will have. Because many of us, all we think about is this dunya. All we think about is how to make more money, how to have a more comfortable life, how to get a better car, how to get a bigger home. These are the things that we think about in our daily lives. And we really don't spend much time. Be honest with yourself. How much do you think about the hereafter every day? How much do you think about Jannah? And how much do you think about Jahannam? How much of your day is spent in reflection upon the hereafter? You don't have to answer it out loud, but think about it to yourself. And I'm sure for most of us, if not all of us, it is something that is lacking. It is something that is not at the level where it should be. So the ability to constantly focus on the hereafter and to give hereafter more importance than this dunya, this is a special quality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to special people. And of course, the prophets of Allah are the most special of people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna akhlasnahum bikhalisatin dhikra ad-dar." Surely we gave these people a special quality, and that special quality was the ability to remember and to focus on the hereafter. وَإِنَّهُمْ عِنْدَنَا لَمِنَ الْمُصْطَفَيْنَ الْأَخْيَارِ. And surely these people, these servants, they were from the chosen ones. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He chose and raised these people above others. They were from المصطفين الأخيار, the chosen ones and the most excellent servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Ibrahim and Ishaq and Yaqub, the father, the son, and the grandson. Ibrahim was the father of Ishaq, Ishaq was the father of Yaqub. In the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions some more prophets of his as well. وَذْكُرْ إِسْمَاعِيلَ وَالْيَسَعَ وَذَا الْكِفْلِ وَكُلٌّ مِّنَ الْأَخْيَارِ. And remember Ismail, the ayah that we just mentioned, where it is mentioned about Ibrahim and Ishaq and Yaqub. One of the sons of Ibrahim is mentioned in this ayah, Ishaq. And in this ayah, the other son is mentioned. وَذْكُرْ إِسْمَاعِيلَ وَالْيَسَعَ وَذَا الْكِفْلِ وَكُلٌّ مِّنَ الْأَخْيَارِ. And remember Ismail and Al-Yasa' and Dhul Kifl. As for Ismail alayhi salam, he was the son, the first son of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And from his lineage came our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is from the sons or from the from the descendants of Ismail alayhi salam. And we have spoken, when we spoke about the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, we also spoke about Ismail alayhi salam as well. But as for the other two prophets who are mentioned in this ayah, Al-Yasa' and Dhal-Kifl, they are prophets that their story is not mentioned in the Quran. Rather, they are just mentioned by name in the Quran, but their stories are not mentioned in the Quran. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did say about them, وَكُلٌّ مِّنَ الْأَخْيَارِ. And all of them were from Al-Akhyar. They were from the best and the most excellent of the people. Of course, prophets of Allah are a level above anyone else. The best of mankind are the prophets of Allah. The best of mankind are the prophets of Allah. And there is no way that a non-prophet can ever, ever reach the level of a prophet. A non-prophet can never reach the level of a prophet. That's why it is said that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the best of mankind after the prophets. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the best of all mankind after the prophets. Meaning, of course, because he was not a prophet, he does not reach the level of any of the prophets. But as for the people who are not prophets, he is the best of them. He is number one. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about these prophets of his, وَذْكُرْ إِسْمَاعِيلَ وَالْيَسَعَ وَذَا الْكِفْلِ وَكُلٌّ مِّنَ الْأَخْيَارِ. Remember Ismail and remember Al-Yasa' and remember Dhul Kifl, and all of them were from Al-Akhyar. All of them were from the best and the most excellent of the people. As for Ismail alayhi salam, we have went over his story. But as for these two other prophets of, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in this ayah, Al-Yasa' and Dhul Kifl, as we mentioned in the Quran, their story is not mentioned at all. But there are some narrations and some reports that mention the stories of these prophets, and we'll briefly go over the stories of these two prophets, Al-Yasa' and Dhul-Kifl, inshallah. As for Al-Yasa', Al-Yasa' ibn Akhtub, it is mentioned that he was from the descendants of Yusuf alayhi salam. He was from the lineage of Yusuf alayhi salam. And he was a prophet of Allah who was given prophethood after the prophet Ilyas alayhi salam. And actually Al-Yasa', he accompanied Ilyas, and he was a follower of Ilyas, and then he was given prophethood as well. Ilyas is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is mentioned in some surahs, and he is mentioned, his story, part of his story is mentioned very briefly in Surah As-Saffat. And to really understand who Al-Yasa' was, we have to have some background as to who Ilyas alayhi salam was. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the story of Ilyas briefly in Surah As-Saffat, وَإِنَّ إِلْيَاسَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And surely Ilyas, he was from the messengers. إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ أَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. When he said to his people, don't you fear Allah? Don't you have taqwa? أَتَدْعُونَ بَعْلًا وَتَذَرُونَ أَحْسَنَ الْخَالِقِينَ. Do you call upon Baal? And Baal was the name of an idol that they worshipped. So Bani Israel, even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give them prophet after prophet after prophet, they would have so many prophets that would come one after another, they would still fall into shirk from time to time. So when Ilyas alayhi salam was sent to Bani Israel, they had fallen into shirk, they had fallen back into the worship of idols, and one of their idols was an idol named Baal. So Ilyas said to them, أَتَدْعُونَ بَعْلًا. Do you call upon Baal? Do you call upon this worthless idol that can bring you no benefit and no harm? وَتَذَرُونَ أَحْسَنَ الْخَالِقِينَ. Allah, رَبَّكُمْ وَرَبَّ آبَائِكُمُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. You call upon Baal and you forget and you don't give attention and you leave off Allah, the best of creators. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of all. And Allah is your Lord, and He is the Lord of those who came before you. So Ilyas, he called his people, he called Bani Israel to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone at a time where they had forgotten about Allah and they had fallen back into shirk and the worship of idols. So as we mentioned, as for Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send them prophets, but they would have separate kings. So the king of the people would be one person, and the prophet would be someone whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to them. Except for Sulaiman alayhi salam and Dawood alayhi salam, who were prophets and they were also kings of their people. But other prophets of Bani Israel, they were prophets, but they were not kings. So Ilyas was a prophet to Bani Israel, but he was not a king. And the land of Ash-Sham, where all of these prophets came from, it was a big land. And it didn't only have one king. Rather, different parts of Ash-Sham had different kings. So there were multiple kings in that land. So Ilyas alayhi salam, he tried to call his people to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they rejected him. They continued to worship their idols, except one of those kings. And as we mentioned, there were multiple kings. One of those kings accepted the call of Ilyas alayhi salam, and he accepted the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this king, his name was Ahab. So Ahab, he listened to Ilyas alayhi salam, and he took what Ilyas alayhi salam gave him as the truth. He accepted it as the truth, and he obeyed Ilyas alayhi salam. But after some time, this king, Ahab, he saw that the other kings of Sham, that they were still able to continue to amass wealth. They were still eating and they were still drinking and they were still living comfortably and luxuriously, even though they didn't accept the call of Ilyas alayhi salam, even though they continued to worship the idols. So after some time, Ahab, he said, look, you called me to the worship of Allah and I accepted your call, but I still don't see that I have any benefit over those other kings. They're still enjoying their kingdoms just as I'm enjoying my kingdom. They still eat and drink as I eat and drink. I don't see any benefit for me over them, even though I accepted your call, Ya Ilyas, and those kings didn't. So I think that what you're telling me, what you have taught me, is all wrong. I think that I made a mistake in following you. And he rejected Ilyas after having accepted him, meaning he turned back upon the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you imagine this? Accepting a prophet and then rejecting him. But this was the case of Ahab. And he returned back to the worship of idols, just like his people were worshipping idols. So this was the situation that Ilyas alayhi salam had to deal with. So after this, and after seeing this one person who actually followed him, this king, after seeing him turn back on his heels and reject guidance after having been given guidance, this made Ilyas alayhi salam very sad and very upset. And at this point, Ilyas alayhi salam, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, Allahumma inna bani Israel qad abaw illa an yakfuru bik wal ibadata li ghayrik faghayyir ma bihim min ni'matik. So Ilyas, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, Bani Israel has rejected, they have rejected the call of Tawheed, and they don't want to do anything except disbelieve in you, and they want to worship other than you, Ya Allah. So take away the ni'mah that you have given them. Take away the blessings that you have bestowed upon them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered the dua of Ilyas alayhi salam, and he said to Ilyas, their rizq, their provisions, I'm putting it in your hand, Ya Ilyas. It is under your control. So Ilyas alayhi salam, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, give them a drought, afflict them with a lack of rain. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afflicted them with drought. So for 3 years, no rain came to them. For 3 years, no rain, until the plants died, the animals died, and the people, they were suffering. The people were suffering due to this drought, which caused a famine. So they didn't have anything to eat. So they were in a very, very difficult situation at this time. So during this time, while the drought was going on, Ilyas alayhi salam, he removed himself from the public platform. He wasn't openly associating with the people anymore. And the people, of course, they were angry with him, they hated him because of the fact that he called them to Tawheed. And this was always the case with the messengers. مَا يَأْتِيهِمْ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Any messenger that came to their people, they were always treated harshly by the people, they were always mocked by their people. And Ilyas alayhi salam was no exception to this. So during this period of drought, Ilyas alayhi salam, he removed himself from public speaking and from coming out in front of the people, and he basically went into hiding. So he would seek refuge in the houses of some of the people if they would allow him to stay. So people would be made aware of where Ilyas alayhi salam was staying in some situations, because the rizq of Ilyas alayhi salam, it would come with him. So even though the people, they were affected by this drought and their rizq was made very limited, the rizq of Ilyas, it remained intact. So whenever the people, they would smell the smell of fresh bread coming from a certain place, a certain house, they would know Ilyas is there. And those people of that house, they have allowed Ilyas to take refuge and to stay in their house. So they would go and they would try to hurt and harm those people of that household for allowing Ilyas to seek refuge in that house. So they would know by the smell of the fresh bread where Ilyas was, because his rizq would come wherever he was, subhanAllah. But instead of seeing this as a sign, instead of seeing this as a sign that Ilyas is on the truth and that they were upon batil, that they were upon falsehood, they didn't do that. Rather, they continued to reject Ilyas and they continued to try to hurt and harm anyone who would allow Ilyas to stay in their home or to take refuge in their home. So one day, Ilyas, he took refuge in the home of a woman, and this woman had a son, and her son's name was Al-Yasa' ibn Akhtub. And Al-Yasa' is the one who is mentioned in Surah Sa'd. So he took refuge in the home of this woman. This woman had a son named Al-Yasa' ibn Akhtub, young boy. And he had an illness. He had some type of a sickness. So Al-Yasa', he was ill and he was sick, this young boy, staying with his mother. And Ilyas, he came to their home and he sought permission to seek refuge there and to stay there. And this woman gave him permission. And she kept his secret. She didn't allow anyone to know that Ilyas was staying there. And she was able to hide him successfully. And he appreciated this very much. So he made dua for this boy. He made dua for Al-Yasa, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure him of that illness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured him of that illness. So now Al-Yasa, he's very attached to Ilyas. And he becomes a disciple. He becomes a follower of Ilyas. So he follows Ilyas. He goes with Ilyas wherever Ilyas goes. And eventually Ilyas, he went back to face the people. He had been in hiding for a period of time, but eventually he decided to go back and to face his people, to face Bani Israel. And he said to Bani Israel, "Ya Bani Israel, you have been suffering for 3 years now, no rain. And because of no rain, your plants and your animals have died and you have no food. I will make dua to my Lord. I will make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to return your rizq and to bring rain down to you if you promise me that if you see this sign, you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you rain after I make dua to him. You have to promise me that you will believe in Allah and that you will stop worshipping these idols." So they made this promise to Ilyas that if we see this, then we will know that you are telling us the truth and we will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and we will abandon the worship of all of these idols. So after he took this promise from them, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Ya Allah, restore the rain to them." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, immediately he restored the rain to them. And they saw this in front of their eyes, but they didn't keep their word and they returned back to the evil that they were upon and they continued to worship their idols instead of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine what the prophets of Allah had to go through. So this is what Ilyas alayhi salam had to go through, and these were the people that Ilyas alayhi salam was sent to. Eventually, after Ilyas alayhi salam, prophethood was given to Al-Yasa' ibn Akhtub, the one who accompanied him and the one who followed him. So after Ilyas alayhi salam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave prophethood to Al-Yasa' ibn Akhtub, and he became the prophet to those same people, and he continued to call them to Allah. He continued to give them da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the sharia and upon the methodology of Ilyas alayhi salam. So this is a short version of the story of Al-Yasa' ibn Akhtub, whose story is not really mentioned in the Quran, but there are some reports that mention these details of his story. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions another prophet, Dhul-Kifl. Again, Dhul-Kifl, he's mentioned by name in the Quran, but his story is not mentioned in the Quran at all. And he was, according to some reports, actually the son of Ayyub alayhi salam, and his real name was Bishr ibn Ayyub. And Ayyub alayhi salam, he's the prophet we spoke about in detail last week, the prophet who was patient upon all of the afflictions that came to him. And we mentioned that from the trials and from the difficulties that Ayyub alayhi salam had to face was that he lost all of his children. He had 14 children and all of them died. But then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured him of his illness and his affliction, he was able to have many more children after that. So after that, he had 26 new children, alhamdulillah. And from those children was a child named Bishr. And he was a great son, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Bishr ibn Ayyub prophethood as well. And he became known as Dhul-Kifl. Even though his name was Bishr ibn Ayyub, he became known as Dhul-Kifl. And the reason why he became known as Dhul-Kifl was because of the responsibilities that he took upon himself, the covenants that he took upon himself to fulfill. And Dhul-Kifl, basically it means the one of covenants, the one who took covenants and he fulfilled those covenants. So from the covenants and from the responsibilities that Dhul-Kifl took upon himself was he took it upon himself that anyone from amongst his people who had any type of need, who was in need of anything, that Dhul-Kifl would take care of that for him. Dhul-Kifl would take care of the needs of his people no matter what they needed. If anybody was unable to pay back a debt that he owed to someone, Dhul-Kifl would take care of that. Anyone needed help with anything, Dhul-Kifl was the one who took it upon himself that he would take care of the affairs of his people. Also, he took a covenant and took a responsibility upon himself that he would judge between the people. Any dispute or disagreement that his people had, Dhul-Kifl took it upon himself that he would judge between them with justice. So that was another responsibility that he took upon himself. Regarding the responsibilities and the covenants between himself and his Lord, between himself and Allah, he took it upon himself, he took a covenant with Allah that he would fast every day during the day and he would pray during the night, every night. So every night he would pray Qiyamul Layl and every day he would fast. And this was a covenant that he took with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So because of all of these covenants that he took, covenants between himself and his people and covenants between himself and Allah, these responsibilities that he took upon himself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls him Dhul-Kifl, the man of covenants, the man who took these covenants and he fulfilled all of these covenants. And this is Dhul-Kifl alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again, he says about these prophets, وَكُلُّمْ مِنَ الْأَخْيَارِ, and all of them were from the most excellent of the people. They were from the most excellent of mankind. The people who have been given prophethood by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are the best of the people. Ismail and Al-Yasa' and Dhul-Kifl, they are all from the most excellent and from the best of the people. هذا ذكر. This is a reminder. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning all of these prophets and their stories. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a reminder. Think about these people. Reflect upon these people. This is a reminder. هذا ذكر. وَإِنَّ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ لَحُسْنَ مَآبٍ. And surely for the muttaqeen, for the people who have taqwa, you will have a good end. You will have a good end. Just like these prophets, they kept their duties towards Allah. They feared Allah. They had taqwa. Allah gave them a good end. If you have taqwa as well, if you follow in the footsteps of these people, of these great servants of Allah, then you will have a good end as well. And this is a reminder for all of us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to benefit from this reminder. Ameen. Inshallah, next week we'll continue with our tafsir of Surah Sa'd. And just as a reminder, the seerah class for this week is cancelled. We'll not have a seerah class this week because I have a prior engagement that I have to attend. But inshallah, the seerah class will resume next Wednesday. And this tafsir class, inshallah, will be next Monday as well. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from all of us. Ameen. Wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.